Our opening words this morning come from Leslie Takashi. Here in this place of peace, may we find hope. Here in this place of connection, may we find life-giving community. Here in this place of rest, let the unrest of our souls turn us towards justice. Here in this space made sacred by memories of connection, let us each feel ourselves part of the new that grows from out of the old into the spiraling unity of the years.
Martin this morning is going to be talking about soft and hard blessings, and I'm very anxious to hear what those soft and hard blessings are. When I think of blessings, the first thing I think of is my family, my husband, my children, grandchildren. But too often, I take them for granted. And too often, I don't think about the other blessings in my life. And I think that is true probably of lots of us. It certainly is true of the gentleman in my story. The title of it is The Edge of the World. It is a traditional story, so the author is unknown. There was once a young man who lived at the top of a mountain in a beautiful redwood house. And although he seemed to have everything one could want, he thought something was missing. He thought about it and decided he had no blessings. He wondered why. He finally decided he would go ask a wise woman. And the wise woman said, "Oh, you'll have to ask God about that." "Well, where do I find God?" asked the young man. "At the edge of the world." So the young man took off walking to the east. He walked and he walked and he walked and he walked and he walked until he came to a clearing. There were foxes on both sides of the clearing. To the left was a group of foxes with beautiful fur glaring at him. So he went to the right. There was one scrawny, skinny fox. And that, not a fox, a wolf. And that wolf said to him, "Where are you going?" "Well, I'm going to the edge of the world to ask God why I have no blessings." "Ooh, would you do me a favor?" said the wolf. "Would you ask God why I'm so skinny and scrawny and not strong and beautiful like my brothers and sisters over there?" "Oh, sure, sure," said the young man. And he started off walking. He walked and 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 he walked until he came to a short, tiny tree standing amongst all these majestic, beautiful trees with the branches reaching to the sky. And the tiny little tree said, "Where are you going?" "Well, I am going to the edge of the world to ask God why I have no blessings." "Oh, would you do me a favor? Would you ask God why I'm so tiny and short?" "Oh, certainly," said the young man. And he set off walking. He walked and 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 he walked until he came to a lovely white house surrounded by a picket fence. He opened the gate and walked in and saw a colorful garden surrounding the house. He knocked on the door. A beautiful young woman came to the door. She smiled and said, "Oh, how nice of you to stop by. Please come in." She fixed him a fabulous dinner. And after dinner, they ate and talked late into the night. And then finally the young woman said, "Where are you going?" Oh, I'm going to the edge of the world to ask God why I don't have any blessings. And the young woman said, oh, would you do me a favor? Would you ask God why I am so lonely? Oh, certainly, said the young man. He rested that night and started off the next day, walking and walking and walking and walking and walking and walking, until he came to the edge of the world. And sure enough, there was God, floating on a white blue cloud. And the young man said, God, why don't I have any blessings? God folded his arms, glared at him, and said, because you are dumb. I have given you blessings. They're all around you. What do I do then? Said the young man. Keep your eyes open. You will see them. Okay. And then the young man started to ask the question from the wolf and the tree and the beautiful young woman. But God said, stop. I know what you're going to ask. I am God. God floated over, and he whispered the answers into the young man's ear. And the young man said, well, thank you. And he took off walking in search of his blessings. He walked and walked and walked and walked and walked and walked, and walked until he came to that lovely white house with the picket fence. The beautiful young woman again asked him in, cooked him a wonderful dinner, after which he said, that is the best meal I've ever had. Oh, thank you, she said. Did you ask God about why I am so lonely? Oh, yes, the young man said. God said you need to get a husband, and then you will be happy. Wonderful, said the young woman. Will you be my husband? Oh, no, thanks. I'm sorry. I'm too busy. I have to find my blessings. But I tell you what, the first nice young man I run into, I will send him to you to be your husband. And he took off walking. Walking and walking and walking and walking and walking until he came to that tiny short tree. Did you ask God about why I'm so short and tiny? Indeed I did, said the man. He said there is a treasure chest of gold right underneath you, and it is keeping your roots from growing and getting all the proper nutrients. That's why you're not growing. Could you get a shovel and dig up that treasure chest so I can grow? Sorry, I would love to, but I'm too busy. I need to find my blessings. But I tell you what, the first strong young man I see, I will send him to you to dig up that treasure chest. Thank you, said the tree. The young man took off walking and walking and walking and walking and walking until he came to that scrawny, skinny wolf. Did you ask God about why I'm so skinny and scrawny? Indeed I did, said the young man. God said, you should eat the first dumb animal you meet. And he did. So the moral of the story is, if you don't recognize your blessings, celebrate your blessings, you might just get called dumb by God. Thank you.
How many of us, I wonder, have said to another person, count your blessings? How many of us have heard those words? Perhaps we were discouraged. Perhaps we were alone. Perhaps we were nursing a deep pain. And so someone, in an effort to turn us around, pointed towards something outside of ourselves and said, count your blessings. The notion of blessings is very old. When I've read through the scriptures, I remember blessing upon blessing. In the Hebrew scriptures, I remember stories of Esau and Jacob, both vying for a blessing from their father. And the lesson in the Old Testament is that blessings are eternal. It's magic. One person can confer a blessing upon another, and it cannot be revoked. It must stand the test of time, and God must witness, and God, him or herself, cannot revoke that blessing. When we move through time and scriptures into the newer Christian tradition, you hear litany after litany. You hear the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who are hungry. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed. We go from that to the more mundane. When a person sneezes, our reaction is to say, bless you. In his work, Bertrand Russell speaks about that type of blessing and describes it as a relic from an ancient past, something which is improbable, and if you think upon it, it is actually ridiculous. Going back to the tradition where we believe that the soul or spirit of a human being can be sneezed out of your nostrils when you blow your nose. And so, in a medieval era, they devised this refrain, bless you, to stop the action midstream, as it were, so that your soul would return unto you. I note that we have no corresponding phrase when a person coughs. Count our blessings. In my life, prior to ministry, I was aware of blessings everywhere. I had placards and signs to remind me to count my blessings. Growing up in my household in South Holland in an Irish Catholic family, we had various plaques that would describe a blessing, some of them fairly old. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. So forth and so on. And may the devil not know you're dead until a half hour after you have passed. A blessing which I could not have shared this past week as I hobbled from place to place with my foot in a boot was, may those who love us, and those that don't love us, may God turn their hearts. And if he doesn't turn their hearts, may he turn their ankles so that we will know them by their limping. I find that most traditions probably have a long legacy of both giving blessings or withholding them, in fact, turning them and making a curse. It is, as I say, as old as magic. In a fearful world where we cannot predict from moment to moment what is to befall us next or those whom we love or the crops in the field, blessings become necessary. They are tools to turn the agents, the unseen spirits, towards our favor. But now in a postmodern age, we retain that particular relic. And the question is why? Why do we bless each other? Why do we bless each other with words? Why, when clergy are ordained, do we lay on hands and confer our blessing through touch? Why do I often end a sermon with the tag phrase, "Thus may we further the blessings of creation"? It's a very, very old habit, and it's one that is deeply infused in the religious imagination. Imagine, if you will, a world without blessings. It seems rather barren to me. In the story which Martha so graciously and wonderfully shared with us, we are reminded that blessings, so to speak, are all around us. But that type of blessing, and the blessings that we can imagine for ourselves, that we can count on our fingers, are really a way of saying, I dodged another bullet. I'm still alive. I'm still in good health. My fortune is strong. Such words may fall deaf on those who are struggling as they compare what may seem an absence of blessings to those who are bursting with the same. In our private lives, in our religious lives, we often can speak of soft or hard blessings. A soft blessing for me might be a cool pillow on a warm summer night, or the turning of the seasons towards autumn, when my allergies begin to subside and the insects no longer badger me. A blessing on an athletic field might be a football player having scored a touchdown, kneeling to praise whomever it may be, to thank whatever blessing has been conferred. We have heard how, in time of war, blessings are often invoked from the Most High. And we have perhaps heard or read Mark Twain's unique debunking of that particular tradition. And yet we still do it day after day. We count our blessings. We hope for the best for ourselves and those whom we love. And when we're at our best for strangers whom we have never met, perhaps for Syrian refugees, perhaps for unarmed black men and women who are stopped by police. Blessings indeed. A soft blessing in a religious context might be to say that when a person is in difficulty, that our pastoral care committee can go and spend time with that individual. We can bring food and break bread. We can listen without trying to interrupt to make points, but just be present to fulfill the role of a chaplain. Perhaps when we bring food to those who are homeless at the Springfield Overflow Shelter, again, sharing a blessing. Every change for change collection that goes to a local charity is an act of conferring a tangible blessing on other people, sharing from our bounty to those in need. And so those particular blessings are not blessings conjured out of words and magic, but they are tangible, they are real, made real by our hands and made incarnate, not by thought, but by deed. Hard blessings. Hard blessings are a little bit different. I first thought of that phrase when I was listening to a young lady talk about being with her father as he died. He had a very difficult cancer. It was long, it was hard on him. It ate away his flesh, it ate away his mind, and his family that sat with him through hour after hour after hour, holding his hand, holding his being with them until he breathed his last. When she shared this particular story with me, how she was able to be present with him at the end of his suffering. My response was, well, that too was a blessing, but it was a very, very hard blessing for you. And she knew instantly what I meant. Hard blessings are those where we are so connected in compassion and love to a person suffering that we walk with them on that journey. And we carry the sting, we carry the injury, just as surely as when Jacob wrestled with the angel, he too was wounded and limped. He received a blessing, but it was a hard blessing. And that is why when I speak of being a minister, when I speak of being ministers amongst us, I often refer to the image of the wounded healer. Every individual that we have ever encountered, persons in this room not excepting, has had not only setbacks, but wounds. Wounds that cut deeply and even silently, unseen to other people. Time, they say, heals all wounds, but we know that that's not really true. We know that the wounds stay with us, and perhaps that is a blessing. A curious blessing, a hard blessing, but when we can revisit those wounds, it breaks open our compassion for other people who are also suffering so that we can be with them in the moment, not preaching, not lecturing, but actually being present with the person in their pain. There's a story that I love from the Buddhist tradition, and it tells of a young woman, a young mother, who lost her son after several months, and she sought out the Buddha. She had, actually it was much sooner, it was only several days after she'd lost her son, because she still had her son with him. And she swaddled her son, wrapped him in clothing, brought him to the Buddha, and laid this child at the Buddha's feet, tears streaming down her face. And she said, "Dear Buddha, bless me and my child. Restore him to life." The Buddha was moved in his heart. Whatever he thought in his head, he asked her to stand and he held her. And he said, "Dear lady, I will restore your son to life, but first, you must bring to me a bowl full of rice from a home that has never known death." And so she left. And she knocked on door after door, village after village. She wore out several pairs of sandals. She would knock on one door and say, "Can you give me a bowl of rice?" And the person inside would say, "Well, yes, of course." And then she would think, "Wait, it's a special bowl. Can you promise me that no one has died in this home?" The person in the door would burst into tears and say, "My beloved spouse has died. I cannot give you such a bowl." And the young lady who had lost her child was drawn into conversation and began to console those whom she met, door to door, village to village. And at the end of several weeks, it dawned upon her that this was a fruitless task to find such a bowl. And yet in her journeys, in her conversations, in offering consolation and receiving consolation, she found that she was now the bearer of a blessing, a hard blessing. And so she returned to Buddha. He saw her, he recognized her, he rose, he extended his hands. He did not expect her to come forward with a bowl of rice. But she came forward and said, "I understand. This is my injury, my thorn to carry through life. But I've also learned that by being with other people, listening and sharing and crying together, we have moved each other and moved forward on the healing process." I would ask you to think for a moment, not about the soft blessings, not about the blessings that we convey with words, but about the more authentic, deep, hard blessings that we have endured and that we have shared with other people. How often have we encountered a person in the grip of grief and not responded as we might have? How many times have we seen a person broken and kept moving? How often have we heard of people's losses and then turned the channel or surfed to the next page? We don't want to see all that ugliness. It's too much. It's overwhelming. There's such a thing as compassion fatigue, you know. And yet, as Martha's story reminds us, to be aware is perhaps the greatest blessing that we can give to ourselves and give to other people. To be aware of what is around us and who is around us and where they are in their lives. And not to shrink away, but to walk by their side, to encourage them, to help them, to bring them food when they need it, to bless them in their darkness. I wish that we could accumulate our blessings, a basket of blessings, if you will, and that we could remove a particular blessing like a rock or stone from the basin of the stone communion and offer it to someone who will hold it in their hands and by virtue of that touch understand all the blessings, all the goodwill, all the prayers infused into that one particular object. But it's often not that way. In my experience, it's never been that way. We have to respond to a person's suffering by actually being engaged with them and not passing it off to another person. And so when I say, let us further the blessings of creation, what I'm inviting us to do is to focus on all the range of blessings, but in particular those hard blessings. To be with one another. To offer comfort. To offer that grace. To offer a spirit that so that people will know that they are never truly alone. And if we can do that, I believe that we will walk forward together, never truly alone, so that when we do stumble, when we do fall, we will always rely on others around us to lift us up and to move forward with our slow and faltering steps. Thus may it be. Amen and blessed be. For our closing words, I offer you this blessing by my colleague Duke Gray. The blessing of truth be upon us, and may the power of love direct us and sustain us, and may the peace of this community preserve our going out and our coming in from this time forth until we meet again.